I have the tough luck to be the first presenter after lunch. That's always a tough time, but I'll try to keep you awake. As it was said, my name is Jan Iversen, and I'm a little more known on our IRC as Jan IV. And I will be talking on a new monitoring system. Not that we don't have a monitoring system. We have Nagios at the moment, which functions sort of some days good, some days less good. But I have some questions, so I'll lead you up to why do we monitor, and then I'll tell you how do we monitor. First, why monitor at all? It's not really needed. Then we'll go through what is actually our artifacts that we are monitoring, and who is doing it, and then a little bit about the setup, and then comes the, for me, the most interesting part, where we go through the actual monitoring workflow, which also gives you as committers an idea of where can you influence the system. Your projects can actually come into this monitoring system and add features to it, or get your part monitored. Oh, this is just very short. I am an infra committer, but I will present things here who does not yet have consensus in infra. So it's set. Why monitor at all? Our biggest data center, which is in Oregon, handles 200 megabit traffic per day, 24/7. We have about 175 up and 25 down. It's quite a good set of traffic for a single data center. We handle 1.5 million mails per day. That's 18 mails per second. Not bad. I'm happy I don't have to write them all. We only have 25,000 that comes in. The rest is due to our mailing list because that's a multiplication factor that goes out. The usage is more or less 50-50 between US and Europe. We have a web page that tells you where you can go in and see some statistics. I've printed the web page here. In this web page, you can sort of see our subversion commits and our mailing on a yearly basis. Now comes a little interesting thing. We've been quite lazy lately. The commits goes down. What's happening? Apache is not stopping. On the other hand, some of the infra people have been doing some very interesting job that allows us to use Git. And that was, the count there was subversion. We have about 7,000 Git commits this year. Last year, compared over the same period, was only 1,000. So that is rising. And if I add those two figures, we are having more commits than we had last year. So we are not lazy. We are simply splitting our repos in Git and in Subversion. What are we actually monitoring? To be honest, currently it's only a fraction of what should be monitored that are being monitored. But we are going to get or change something with that. The new system is called Circonus, and it gives us possibilities that we didn't have with Nagios. With Nagios, we were always behind. Nagios told us, oh, you have a problem with that server. And yes, we had to react immediately. With Circonus, we have a possibility to predict alerts before they even happen. We have the possibility to go in on a VM, for instance, measure its memory usage. An alert would be generated if the memory usage is higher than a certain limit, but we can measure a trend over time. And then we can see sort of, let's say we set a threshold on 2%, and if it grows faster than 2% a day, or our accumulation period, we will get an alarm before we actually have a problem. And that's sort of nice because that means we in infra can plan the work a little bit better, just a little bit better. We can do the same with disk. One of the problems I've seen on the VMs is often disk runs full. And we get the alert and it's not nice having a disk full and having to rescue it. We also have an idea of CPU overloads or CPU usage in general. Circono stores all the information in a big database, so we can go in and predict if we move this VM from one center to another center, how will that affect the underlying machine? And of course, the last one, it can warn when a project VM is not being maintained. We have seen, we have a lot of project VMs and the maintenance states of the project VMs vary quite a bit. So let's see our structure. You see it from the outside, you go to our repo. Basically, you work typically with UL, sometimes with SSH on people especially. But in total, we have 7 data centers around the world. We used to have 8, but we lost one. And on the other hand, we have a new one in Australia that is being considered at the moment. So we would have a 3-leg situation. If I drill into the data centers, then we have at the moment 43 hosts, physically machines that we control. I should say at this point, we also have a number of VMs at, for example, at Yahoo, where we don't have the physical host, we only have the VMs. So somebody else is hopefully monitoring the physical machine quite good. Drilling a leg further down, we have, this slide is 3 weeks old. At that point, we had nearly 90 VMs and Yales. We have several that are pending because we have right now a discussion of changing our VM technology. So once that discussion is finished and up and running, we have something like 6-7 VMs that are waiting for that, including that we are opening up for CentOS for special purposes. We have at the moment only 133 URLs that are being monitored. That's really not a lot. If I look at our DNS, we should have 230. And if I look in reality, because DNS only tells me what are our names. So that would be the top level of the URL we could monitor. But a lot of projects have a master URL and below that have different services. We have the possibility with this system, by the way also with Nagios, to go in and monitor specific URLs. So if you as a project say, okay, I monitor tomcat.apache.org, for instance, that's my main one, but I have a subdomain called register, just an example. Then we can ask the monitoring system to monitor tomcat.apache.org/register. So you will always know that that's up. I'll come back to later how you will know that. But it's an important thing for projects to think about that you can request a monitoring of specific services. Drilling down to the next level, we have a number of special services also, or internal services, if you so like. We also monitor our DNS server. It's clear, that's a very important one. We use GeoDNS for a couple of services, and we monitor that the GeoDNS is actually working. We happen also to be so polite, so we monitor our name, external name server, sort of the next in the hierarchy. More important to me is we have 2 LDAP servers. which is where we store all your usernames and basically all the information of you that are needed to get access to the systems. Which host are you allowed on, etc. That is stored in our LDAP system. The LDAP servers are duplicated, and we control every minute that this duplication is upheld. Meaning, if one server fails, the other one will take over, and it also means we have an automatic backup of the system. We do the same for Subversion. I've never really found out whether the duplication is for backup purposes or it's because it is a split between the US and the EU. So we can balance the load on our systems, but at the same time, it's a nice form of backup. Then we also have different security monitors. I will not list the security monitors here, but we monitor at all times that the security is at the level we want to have it on all our systems. Because Apache is a very known entity out there, there are also a lot of hackers who would like to put on their little sign and saying, I hacked Apache. And I see it with the monitoring system as one of our tasks to make sure that doesn't happen. That is also one of the main reasons why we monitor the project VMs to see that they are maintained carefully. It's not because we want to be the bad guys. It's simply because one bad VM in there, the hackers have entry to that. Where can they hop from there? It depends on the VM, but it's dangerous. So we don't like that. Who are we? We have Sam Ruby, who is the vice president, and a lot more, but he is actually our top boss. We have below him, he is not working actively on this, he's doing a lot of other things. We have four full-time staff members. With staff, I mean people who are actually paid to be available for us. And they do a hell of a lot of good job. Below that, we have seven what we call root. InfraRoot is a special group. If you look on people, you'll see we have InfraRoot, we have Infra, and we have Infra Interest as projects, so to say. The seven root are people who have a lot of power. They can basically do what they like to do. So root is not something that is given lightly, which you can also see by the number. Then when I look, my daily life is actually on the ERC, and when I look, we are about 8 normal committers who are actively coming in and out. We have in total 95 committers who have access to our repo. It is so that people who are committers, who are infra, have write access. People who are infra interest have read access in general. Let's drill this down a little bit. How did I do this? Karma. All staff and root are members per definition, because they have access to everything. So they need to be members, otherwise, if they are not members, they could, as non-members, see information that they shouldn't see. Actually, root might see more than members in certain cases. Some of the active committers are also members, not all, but they are all PMC members in at least one project. All our infra committers, nearly, because I found one exception, which I don't know why, is PMC in at least one project. Infra interest, on the other hand, the ladder for that is a little less. That's just committers They don't need to be on the PMC board, but it's typically in a project, a person who cares for the VM, who cares for some of the infra stuff, and he needs read access, he or she needs read access to our repo so that they can provide patches to us. So that's sort of the entry level into infra, is true infra interest. Just like any other project. In any other project, how do you get committer? You start by volunteering and adding patches. When the people get tired of you adding patches and they have to commit them for you, they nominate you as a committer. The naming is different here, but basically it's the same. In an average day on our IRC, you will see that there are 2 to 3 staff members normally throughout the normal working day that's available. But please remark, in case of emergencies, they are all callable. Not by us, but they have their own internal system, how they regulate that. There are between none and 2 root persons active at all times. The root people in general have a tendency to specialize. So you'll find one of the root people is concentrating on HTTP, another is concentrating on our Jira. We can't all do everything. We have 1 to 2 committers active at all times. They also have a tendency to specialize. Then we have, let's jump to the last one, we have what we call project teams. When you get a VM or get any service that is project specific, we would like to have a team behind it, a team from the project. That team, typically 1 to 3 persons, they will receive mail alerts. Whenever anything happens, Circonus detects a problem, it will automatically send a mail out to these people. So it's a good way for you sort of to say, if we don't get a mail, system runs. You don't need to ask infra all the time, is our system running? The team will take care of that. Now, we have something which we call sudo karma, that is having root on the machines. Having root on the machines is a privilege. It's not something that is given lightly. That's also divided. Staff and root have, in principle, access to everything. When I say in principle is that they have sort of the right to have the access, but they get it as needed. It's not so that if you were root, you would automatically, immediately have access to all machines. That's not how it works. It builds on a trust principle. You earn your trust all the way up, and the more trust you have, the more access you get when you need it. There are no reason to give you access to a machine where you might not even know what happens on that machine. The only difference between staff and root is that staff have to be there. Root is volunteers. We have 38 committers who have sudo access or root on project VMs. And here we only talk about the project VMs. Most of these 38, they have 1 to 2 VMs. A little handful, it's actually 4 people. They have access to 3 to 4 servers, and it's typically our build servers. It's typically that a project will have one person, especially if they have a more complex build, that they will have one person who have access to 1 or 2 build servers. And then there's one who has karma to a larger number of VMs, but that's different. Now our teams are set up in a hierarchy. We have all our project teams. Basically, you could replace the name project there with a service or a VM. So it's not projects necessarily in the sense of Tomcat or Kafka, whatever they're all called. It's in our infra terminology. For instance, in OpenOffice, we have 1, 2, 3 teams in total that happens to have more or less the same. Then we have a Circonus admin team, whose purpose is basically to make sure that the monitoring system also works. In case the admin team, the project teams don't react, things get escalated up to an ASF admin team, and that's basically a subset of the root people and the staff people. All core services are also going directly to this team. So this is how we set up our daily work and try to see there are not so many infra people, so we try to push things back to the projects. The projects with the service, they got the service, but they also have a responsibility to maintain that service. And this is how we provide that service for them or provide the possibility. Now, let's dive into the technique. Now we have seen how big our infrastructure is. We have seen how few people who actually manage it and how the structure is. What do we actually have? We have an ASF broker that handles all the checks that needs to be done on our private LAN. We would not like the Circonus server, which is a public server, I don't even know where it is, it's somewhere in the world. We would not like that to have direct access to our LDAP. That would not be cool that server potentially could dive into our LDAP. So we have put in a filter, a private broker that sits in our network that does this kind of monitoring. It monitors LDAP. It monitors for a few services in the moment, the HTTPD connection, so we can actually see traffic numbers, for instance. In the future, we are going to very limited to monitor SMNP. That was when I talked about CPU usage, memory usage, disk usage. It's those kind of very high level SNNP things. It's not that we'll dial down and do that every minute. That would be too costly. The next thing we had was Circonus is a beautiful system. I like it. But it has a number of problems. One of the problems was it did not understand that we had two LDAP servers. So even though I use their ASF broker in our system, it's their code, but they did not understand the concept of synchronizing two servers. It's clear it's because it's more or less something we have made. Same goes for the Subversion sync. So we have put that into a program that we have actually developed and deployed internally. Also, all of our security monitoring is done with our program, so we don't disclose to Circonus or anybody out in the world how our security setup is actually done. We generate configurations, and we have a new status page, which is not alive for general public yet, but it replaces status.apache.org, where you can at all time see the status of all our machines and services. New thing here will be that you can also see if they are in maintenance mode and get a little bit more information. Now, the last thing we had, this Circonus system is like any other web UI. It has a click-click interface to configure it. It's very funny if you have to change the name of a server or change the threshold of a server, click, click, fast done. Try to do that with all our services. It's no fun. Second thing is, we wanted and want very highly to have all our changes recorded in our repo. So if I go in and make change an alert threshold, I have to commit it to the repo so it's identified afterwards that was Jan who made a mistake. And he's the one who can correct it again. But it it's important to have the history of how our configurations have evolved. So we can always prove and say, why did this thing not work? Now, the second thing why we do this is actually a future where you as project people can send us patches. You couldn't send patches to a click-click interface. But now that we talk about an SVN repo, of course you can make a diff, send us the diff, and we can commit it for you. So in a sense, the project VMs is turning in the direction of being self-serve for monitoring. I don't have to understand which URLs you want to have monitored. You tell me in form of patches, we commit it, review it and commit it, and it runs. So it's a beautiful little thing of using Subversion. And the actual activation requires that you are physically on the VM where this stuff runs, and it requires you have sudo karma on that. So let's see, what are we actually offering you? We are giving it in form of a set of macros. We have a simple macro where you see, I want to define a team. You give it a team name, and in this case, two members and another, myself. But you can add the mails you want to have there. And that goes automatically. People who are staff members will automatically get SMS messages because they are on the core services and they have to be up 24/7. All others get mail, and mail is, as mail are, a little bit behind. But I think every project member will be able to send patches like that to us if they want to have a new team. Now, we use the teams, for instance, if we have a new physical host, that would typically not be a project, but in this case, I've taken Harmonia 2008. You can see we also support monitoring of IPv6 and, of course, the old one. It hangs in a data center, so we have a relationship between data center and physical host. So we know sort of, okay, if a data center has a router that goes down, we don't need to think about the hosts in there. Siaconus thinks about that for us because we have an alert chain. When the router goes down, Siaconus says, okay, router down, and we don't need to generate alerts on all the underlying assets. Now, you can see here what we are actually monitoring. We start by monitoring a ping. Okay, we can ping the host, hooray, it's alive. Then we walk on and say, can we actually do SSH to the system? And we, in some cases, uses UVC, we uses fail to ban, we uses a couple of other things. It's examples of what we can do there. But again, that's something that's pretty easy to configure. If I drill down to project level, which is actually the VMs, this is where you are going to make patches. You have exactly the same layout. You need to give it a name. You need to give it the IP address. You need to tell, you need to tell on which physical host it's hosted. You need to give the IP name, and you need to give this, I got it completely wrong, name, IP, and physical host. And you have the same, here you have the possibility, for instance, to say, I want my HTTPD instance monitored. Monitored in this sense would be traffic monitoring, that we collect statistic, how many hits do you get per minute? That can be quite useful for a project over time to see a graph. How is my load actually? I used it when I configured the OpenOffice wikis. And so we actually had quite a funny load, because in the morning, in the European morning, I would have 1 hour where the system was sweating like, and then 3-4 hours, nearly nothing. In the lunchtime, European lunchtime, we would have a small peak, and then again about 7-8 in the evening. 7-8 in the evening translate basically to the morning in the US. So we, for some reason, I can't tell you why, but it was interesting for me to see that we don't have an average load over the day, but we actually have high peaks. And that gave me a possibility to adjust some of the parameters in HTTPD so it actually acted better on that. Now, on the VMs, we'll typically serve URLs. We call them services. In this case, you tell, say, on this host or this VM, we have this DNS name running. And we also want to have a sub part of it. So I'm actually monitoring with this www.eu.apache.org, that's automatically added to it, /dyn/closer.cdi. It's monitored for HTTP, and I guess you have already thought, of course, that could have an S as well, so you can also monitor HTTPS. And now comes the funny part. Where does the alert go? In this case, it goes to the ASF admin team, but that would typically be your name. That macro is a macro I expect the projects to send it to us and say, we would like this monitored. And if you give us a patch with these macros, we can add them to the system. Now, how does this all work? Now I've configured it, and we still have our little set of people. I have, or I don't, Circonus has 12 brokers distributed around the world. The brokers checks what I've just been describing, does the checks, and sends it into a big metric database. The database is not only keeping the last record, it keeps record over a long time. Currently, I've set it up to have records 2 years back. So we can, in this case, for all checks, go in and see how many non-200 did we get on our URLs. It's again a trend analysis I can start to do and saying, if my number of failed 200 increases, then I might start to have a problem with that VM, and we can proactively go in and do something about it. Based on the collection of data, I can do alerts. It's clear I put in thresholds and say, if I ping and 4 out of 10 pings fails, give me an alert. That goes out to SMS or email. And I can analyze the data, send it to the status page. I can do a lot of graphs. It's more fun. And I can do beacons. Beacons is another word, it's their word, for trend analysis. Seeing if a problem slowly gets more and more evident. Now, one thing I think we are, or I'm beginning to think of, is the brokers, using the brokers distributed around the world. We have had several cases, we saw it, was it the day before, with the schedule of Linux Foundation. It didn't work from here, but it worked when we jumped onto a European server and tried to do it with curl, it worked. So you can use, we can use this broker to ping the URL or to start, check the URL from Europe, from Asia, from the US, and see that we have total coverage. And the nice thing is, it's not our server. So just put load on it. And actually, Circonus, who donated the server, would like to see us have a big system. So setting up an alert is a little bit more complex. You have to define your contacts group. You have to define what the metric you're actually alerting on and the criteria for the alert. I'm just showing you to so that you can see that is also in our repo. So the definition of when, how high is the threshold for a ping is not something that is fixed coded in the system. It's in a macro we have made so that any day we can go in and say, I change this alert, and it will automatically work for all pings throughout the system. But it should be a little careful changing that. The alert handling is quite interesting. Again, alert is based on thresholds. We get an alert. The alert will, due to a minor hiccup, it's not working today. I would have loved to present it, but somebody in here is not as strong in Python as he should be. We send it out on IRC to hash ASF infra. It's actually so that we on our IRC channel can control a lot of what happens with the monitoring. We have a little command language for that, just like we had for Nagios. We update the status page. We send email and or SMS depending on what happens. Now, people have a tendency not always to react. So the system will automatically forget SMS, but in case of email, after 6 hours and saying, nobody reacted on this error, so we might have a mail problem. It's of course not people not reading their mail, so we send the email once again. In case the second email, now we're up to 12 hours, and nobody reacts, then we will automatically escalate it so that the infra staff members, the infra root members, knows we have a VM that has a problem and the project haven't attended to it. That does not mean that infra jumps in and does your job. It simply means we know now that we don't care about this server and we might go in and shut it down. Ultimately, if it's not maintained, shutdown is a clear possibility. So, now you're sitting back home, you receive the mail and said, wow, we know we have something. The alert goes through a number of stages. First one is it turns red on the status page. When it's red, it means it's an alert that is undetected. No human have said, oh, it's my alert, I'm going to handle this. So the first thing you do is you go in and acknowledge the alert. That can be done on IRC. And that's new. Nagios does not have that feature. But you can go in and see, we know this alert and we take care of it. And that will change the status. The good thing is, when you do this, you also give a time frame. So say, oh, I can't take care of it right now, but I'll take care of it within 5 hours. And it keeps the acknowledge for 5 hours, but after 5 hours, it returns automatically to alert status and say, hey, that guy promised to do something about me, but you didn't. So we escalate it. Then, of course, you work on it, and you confirm, you can confirm that it's okay, but the system will also automatically detect that now I can ping again, for instance, and when Zirconus can ping again, it will automatically return the status to green. On the new web page, you'll not only be able to see the status of all our system. No, you won't be able to see the status. You can see all servers or services that are red or orange. And then we have an historical page behind it where you can go in and see what happened during the last 3 days, if I remember right. It's 2 or 3 days that it's set up to. So it's a nice way of handling an alert. First, signifying, yes, I have seen it. It's my alert. do it, and you don't need to do any more than repair it, then the system automatically turns green. We also, from time to time, have to do maintenance, this unpleasant thing. What you do then is you go in and set the maintenance system. You did the same in Nagios, you scheduled downtime. It will turn again the same color, but the good thing about maintenance is that you can not only set a time, you have to set a time, but you can also put a note to it. So you can put a textual note to the system saying, why is it down? So it's not only it's down, but it's, no, we are doing an update. We are making your service better. Important is, if you have set it to work and said, I'm going to work 10 hours, if we come out of the 10 hours, it goes in a timeout and goes in an alert state. Sort of to wake up people and say, hey, we have started a work, we haven't acknowledged it finished, so something must be wrong. So it will automatically go into alert state. Once you have finished your job, it happens that we schedule maintenance for 2 hours and it takes 10 minutes. Sometimes Murphy works the other way around and things go smoothly. Then you can go in and cancel the maintenance. That's something we also don't do in Nagios at the moment. But that means that the system will go into green status immediately, or immediately is after 60 seconds. The system pulls in minute cycles. Now, the future of monitoring, where are we going with this? We haven't it in, it's not in real production, it's very close to real production. But we have a couple of things that we want to do, or more correctly, that I want to do. Our SMNP monitoring, we have talked about that. I would also like to see HTTP statistic and send out a graph to all projects or have a page with graph. So all projects can go in and see, how is my homepage actually used? Is anybody looking at it, or is it just sitting there? It might also be a good argument when you come back to Infra and say, I need more memory, I need more disk, and you can show a graph saying, and we have that many hits. It's at least a good argument. We also have a possibility to send the alerts directly to Twitter. And it's an option we have, which I think is good, but it's something we need to discuss a little bit more internally. But most important to me is the last one. I want, we all want in Infra, to have all services monitored. It's a benefit for the project, it's a benefit for the people in Infra, that as much we can automate, let's do it. So, questions? Do you see? 1 to 2 alerts max? Something like that. There are days where the LDAP goes down, and that's days where I wish I was didn't go on the channel. But typically 1 to 2 alerts, and say if we have one really critical alert once a month, about that soon. We have a pretty stable system. So it's the core services runs very good. And the VMs, I would say, I've been a year in Infra, and I get my ideas which VMs are the not so stable ones. Yeah?
You showed that the monitoring core system is not yours? No,
it's donated by a company who with the name Circonus. It sits in their system.
Okay, and how do you access this database?
We have an API, a REST API, where we can access it. So we actually, when we configure the system, we are exchanging JSON objects.
And what kind of database
I don't know, to be honest. And also, to be honest, I don't care. It's a fast system. I tested the system just to see, because now that we got a sponsor, I'm going to test this and see if I can really trick it. So I invented, because in OpenOffice we have a lot of sub URLs. So I added 10,000 URLs to the system and said, please ping it every 10 seconds, check it. And I hate to admit it, but it didn't even seem to sweat. It's a good system. It is, all, of course, also sold commercially. So he has to do a good job of it. Okay? More questions? Then thank you. So.